Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Saver here from Skew the Script. Growing up, my teachers always jammed in my head, you have to go to college, go to college, go to college. They said it would lead to a higher income, better job, more choice-filled and empowered life. They always raised the question in my mind, is college the right choice for everyone? We're going to explore that question today using a two-sample T interval for a difference of means. Let's skew it. Today's lesson is on the confidence interval for two means. This is lesson 8.3 in our course sequence. We're going to start off today with two facts about college in the United States. Fact number one, on average, college graduates make a lot more money than high school graduates, about $30,000 more per year as of 2018. That piles up over time. Also, fact number two, despite the rising costs of college, the average economic return, the return on investment to a college degree, is still higher than stocks, bonds, and homes. So is this college effect correlational or causal? Some think that it's causal, that going to college directly causes one to have higher earnings. Others think that it might just be a correlation. The higher motivation and skilled high school students end up applying to college. They also independently end up getting higher paying jobs because of that high motivation and skill level they have. So college and those high paying jobs tend to correlate, they happen together, they coincide, but college may have no direct effect on earnings itself. So when we talk about students on the margin of going to college, they're on the fence between the motivation level and the qualification level for college. If the college effect is causal, then educators should encourage those margin students to attend college. But if the college effect is just correlative, then maybe in some cases, educators shouldn't always encourage those students to attend college. There might be certain circumstances that would suggest otherwise. So today's key analysis is, how can we determine if college has a truly causal impact on wages? If you want to follow along using a handout, you can print it up at this URL. So first we're going to talk about something called a quasi-experiment. So usually to infer causation, we have to do an experiment. So in this case, we would get a bunch of students on the margin of attending college, and we would randomly assign half of them to go to college, randomly assign half of them to not go to college. After random assignment, wait 15 years and compare the earnings at the end of that time period. Then you get a causal estimate of the difference. But this is impractical and maybe unethical. You can't really force people to attend or not attend college. So in its place, we have something called a quasi-experiment. In very unique situations, you can use a quasi-experiment to compare as good as randomly assigned groups in observational data. You can make causal estimates from observational data if the situation is right. Now, quasi-experiments are not covered in AP stats. They're a bit of an advanced topic, but we're gonna talk about them today because they help us answer cool questions. They provide a view of advanced stats, a little preview of what's to come when you take more stats courses. And also we can tie it into the tools of AP stats. Specifically today, we're gonna analyze a quasi-experiment today with a two sample T interval, which you do have to know for the AP stats exam. The one we're gonna look at today is called a regression discontinuity. Those kinds of study use an arbitrary cutoff to compare as good as randomly assigned groups. This is a study that we're going to analyze today called the Florida College Study. It's from an economist at Yale, his name is Seth Zimmerman, and he uses a regression discontinuity to explore whether college has a truly causal impact on wages. We're going to look at a modified version of the study, and if you want to see those specific modifications, pause and read through here. Here's the situation that he looked at. In the early 2000s, the Florida State University System had a GPA cutoff. That cutoff was 3.0, so among all the GPAs, they drew a fine line, boom, 3.0. And if you had above this or equal to 3.0, you qualified for standard admission to the university system. If you had below this, you don't qualify. And also different universities had different ways of calculating the high school GPA. So it was hard to know exactly where you would fall. What the regression discontinuity design does, it's gonna compare earnings of students near the cutoff. So those with GPAs just above 3.0 and those just below 3.0. And under certain key assumptions, students close to this threshold that was kind of arbitrarily cut will be pretty similar to one another. So you're gonna have as good as randomly assigned groups on either side of the cutoff, one just above going to college, one just below stopping at high school. So we have to check a few assumptions here to make sure that we have as good as randomly assigned groups. And you don't have to worry too much about these assumptions because this is not covering AP stats, but just if you're curious, one thing you have to check is students on each side have to be similar demographically. They found that they were in terms of race, gender, income, they were very similar and other things as well. Also, you had to ensure that students and teachers could not purposefully manipulate their GPAs to meet this cutoff threshold, and the author provides evidence that they couldn't. So for students near the cutoff, here's what they found. The barely above cutoff students are on the left, labeled college, and the barely below cutoff students who were not offered standard admission are on the right, labeled high school. They measured the income of these students 8 to 14 years after graduating high school. So if college made a difference for the students on the margin, then the just above cutoff, the college students should have a higher income than the just below cutoff students. So we're going to compare the mean incomes from the two groups. And this is a two sample inference procedure because we have two groups and we're comparing their mean. So we want to see if in the population, those who attend college and who were marginal students will have a higher income on average than those who were marginal students and do not attend college. We're going to estimate that by using our sample means from the study. And we find that yes, the college group had a higher mean income and a pretty substantially higher mean income at that, $6,800 per year higher. But keep in mind, there's lots of variation here. There's big standard deviations, and there's less than 300 students per group in this modified version of the study. So could this difference in outcome, the $6,800 higher average for the college-going group, have happened just by chance? Or did college admission actually causally raise their wages? So let's make a confidence interval to see if this difference was large enough to not have happened by chance alone in all likelihood. So let's talk about a two sample T interval for a difference of means. We're gonna define hypotheses here. When you make a confidence interval, you don't have to define hypotheses, but I find that it's helpful to organize our thoughts. So the null hypothesis here is that the mean income among all marginal students who go to college will be the same as those who stop at high school. They are the same, no difference. And the alternative, or maybe trying to find evidence of, is that the college group does in fact make more on average. So to set up these hypotheses in a mathematically convenient way, we're going to subtract the high school average from both sides. And in the null hypothesis, when you do that, you get it should be equal to zero since you are assuming the means are equal. In the alternative, you're testing if the college one is higher. So when you subtract, you should get a positive number. And again, this is a more mathematically convenient way to write these hypotheses. So now let's make the interval. The null is that when you subtract the means, you get zero. The means are equal for college or high school groups. And we want to find the true difference in mean incomes. Where is it compared to that null hypothesis? Well, it might be higher, it might be lower, and we don't really know where it is at because we haven't done this with all students. We haven't randomly assigned them among all these colleges to all these different things. So what we can do is look at our sample and get a point estimate from that. And we found that the difference in our sample between the college average income and the high school group average income was $6,800. The college group made $6,800 on average more than the high school group. So the question is, was this difference due to sampling error, just random chance in the sampling process alone, or is it actually significantly higher than zero? Well, let's make an interval and try and find out. We're gonna use a sampling distribution, which is all the results that could have happened by chance variation in our sampling process. We're gonna get the 95% confidence level interval within that distribution. And so normally we think, okay, 1.96 standard deviations above, 1.96 standard deviations below. So how far is that for this sampling distribution? Well, under certain conditions, this sampling distribution can be modeled by this formula. Normal, centered at the true difference, with this being our standard error term. This is the typical distance of the sampled means from the true mean difference. And it's a fairly complicated formula. We won't get too far into it, but a couple of things to note. The spread here is a combo of the standard deviations of the incomes for the control or the college group and the high school group. And like most estimates we do, the higher the sample size, the lower the spread because those sample sizes are in the denominator. And note also, we're centered at the true difference of means. So let's start to plug into this formula and figure out what the sampling distribution is. We don't know the true difference in means, so we're going to place it with our best guess estimate, which was the $6,800 mean sample mean difference. And we know the sample sizes, so we're going to plug in those sample sizes. The thing is, we don't know the true standard deviation for both groups. So we're going to use the sample standard deviation instead. And as we did before with a one sample interval, we're going to use a wider T distribution to account for the extra uncertainty that comes with using the sample standard deviation instead of the population standard deviations. So we're going to get the standard deviation of incomes in both groups, plug them in. Now we have a T distribution, and we're going to do the math to get the standard error. The standard error here now is $2,484. So that's the typical variation of our estimates from the true mean difference. And we still need to find out what the degrees of freedom is for this T distribution we're using. What we do if we're doing this by hand is we're going to take the smaller group sample size, subtract one from it, and that is our degrees of freedom. The calculator that you'll use will do something slightly different, but by hand we're going to do this method. So the smaller group was the highest group, had 190 students in it, subtract one, 189 is our degrees of freedom. So now we're going to do 1.96 times the standard error out on both sides. That gives us our margins of error. But here's the thing is that we're using a T distribution, and T intervals are going to be a bit wider than normal curve intervals. We need a little bit more of a critical value than 1.96 to capture 95% confidence. So we need to find the T critical value here, labeled as T star. We can do some calculator stuff to figure that out. Go back to lesson 8.1 if you want to see the specific calculator steps. In this case, it's 1.97, a little bit wider than 1.96. This makes sense because at such a high sample size, our T curve is going to be fairly similar to a normal curve. So now we find our margins of error. In this case, 1.97 times the standard error gives us a margin of error a little bit under $5,000, and we get our final interval. So what does this interval mean exactly? Well, we are 95% confident the interval from $1,900 to $11,600 captures the true difference in mean outcomes between the marginal students who attended college and who don't attend college. So we're 95% confident the true mean difference is between those intervals. So the one thing to note here, zero is outside of our interval. All values in our interval are positive, which means that all plausible values have the mean of the college group being higher than the mean of the high school group. So it's not plausible to assume those means are equal. Therefore, we have convincing evidence that college-going marginal students have higher average wages because the differences are all positive. And because the GPA cutoff, as we said before, gave as good as random assignment to college, we showed that this is a positive causal effect on wages for the marginal students who are at the cutoff. So let's talk about how we would show this in terms of the four-step process to get full credit on FRQs. So whenever you get a question like this, construct and interpret an interval, we know I need to do the four steps for inference. I need to organize it with a state plan to conclude. So first, state. We're constructing a 95% confidence interval, the confidence level, for our parameters. Define what your parameters mean. Then name your inference method and check conditions. This is a two sample T interval. If all conditions are met, we'll do it. The conditions, remember, why do we check the conditions? Well, we derived all this from a T distribution, and that was derived from a normal curve. We need to check the conditions to make sure that this is actually accurate. If it's not, then the whole interval is messed up. So we use this normal model to make our confidence interval, and it only works under certain conditions. Those conditions are listed here. We need to check the RAM condition to make sure it's unbiased center. We need to check the 10% condition to make sure that this is the formula we have for calculating the spread. And then we need to make sure that we have a large sample or the data is normal so that our sampling distribution has an approximately normal shape. So we're gonna do a two sample T interval here, random. Students were as good as randomly assigned to college or skip college. We got that from the fact of that cutoff and the regression discontinuity assumption. So we're good there. Now note, if you're doing a sample rather than an experiment, we need to verify the data come from two independent random samples. You need to verify that for a two sample case. 10% condition, this is what that would look like. However, we're doing an experiment, so we don't need to check the 10% condition. That's only for a sampling. So we don't have to worry about it here. Quasi-experiment works the same way. Finally, normal and large sample sizes. We need to make sure that our sample sizes in both groups are both greater than or equal to 30. In this case, we have that. So we're good to go. Last, we perform the calculations. In this case, we go into our calculator, type in what we need to type in. Here are the steps. If you want to try it out on your own, pause the video and give it a shot. Then at the end, report the degrees of freedom that your calculator used, slightly different than what we use. The interval is also gonna be a little bit different than what we use. But it's gonna be fairly similar. It's just different because the calculator uses a slightly different degrees of freedom that's less conservative than what we do by hand. Then finally, interpret your interval. I interpreted this before, so I won't repeat myself, but we give that interpretation in our conclude phase. And then we need to draw a conclusion. In this case, we saw that zero was outside our interval. So yes, it's all the plausible values show us that on average, the college group had higher wages. So let's move on to the discussion question for today. The confidence interval was entirely positive, but one might still wonder, maybe the greater costs of college make this positive effect cancel out. Maybe college doesn't quite pay off. Well, the study author Zimmerman showed that even with the rising college costs, this college boost still represents a net gain over time. The college does pay off. So this has some interesting policy implications. For example, many colleges have tried to recruit more students from underrepresented backgrounds. For example, students of color and low-income students. One problem they have, though, is because students from these backgrounds disproportionately attend lower performing high schools, many apply to college with lower GPAs and lower academic qualifications. And colleges worry that underqualified students will have bad outcomes in college. For example, they might not graduate, they might have student debt, et cetera. So let's have a discussion about this. So say, for example, that universities in Florida, to help recruit students from a wider array of backgrounds, are considering lowering their admission standard for high school GPAs. Would this be a wise move? Explain your answer using the results from the Florida College study. That's it for today, statisticians. Have a good one.